In the summer of 1942, the Japanese Empire stretched over a vast area of the Western Pacific. After the attack on Pearl Harbor in December 1941, Japanese forces moved quickly to capture Hong Kong, Burma, Malaya, Borneo, the Philippines, and Singapore. By the spring of 1942, Japanese troops were in New Guinea as the expanding empire swept into the Solomon Islands. By the end of May, Japanese territory spread as far as the large jungle island that would give its name to one of the best-known episodes of the Pacific War, Guadalcanal. Japan's expansion was a seemingly relentless advance, but around the time they reached Guadalcanal, the tide was already beginning to turn against the empire. The May 1942 Battle of the Coral Sea forced Japan to shelve the idea of attacking New Guinea's capital, Port Moresby. In early June, the stunning American victory at Midway persuaded the Japanese leadership to halt their expansion into the Pacific. Consolidation was now the order of the day. But the empire was still a force to be reckoned with. In the middle of June 1942, Allied intelligence in the Solomon Islands reported a worrying development. The Japanese occupiers of Guadalcanal were constructing an airfield on the north coast of the island. Coconut trees were being felled in their thousands, and the reports suggested that the airstrip would be operational in a matter of weeks. This was serious news for the Allies. A Japanese air presence on Guadalcanal would threaten the precious supply line between Hawaii and Australia. In Washington, the American chiefs of staff considered their response. One idea was to carry out a raid against Guadalcanal and put the airfield out of commission. But eventually a plan was hatched that was far more bold in scope. Instead of merely raiding Guadalcanal, the Americans decided to capture the island. The plan was to effect an amphibious landing by American Marine forces, eject the small Japanese presence, and establish an Allied airbase on the island. By June the 25th, the decision was made to go ahead with the operation. Its code name, Watchtower. When the decision was made to capture Guadalcanal, the American planners knew very little about the background that lay ahead. The island was almost entirely unfamiliar. Maps were few and unreliable, and only a limited air reconnaissance was possible. And this was not the only problem that affected American preparations. The success of the Guadalcanal offensive would depend on the Marine troops, whose task was to go ashore and physically capture the vital airstrip. But when the Marine commander, General van der Grift, received his orders at his headquarters in New Zealand on the 25th of June, he knew that his men were far from combat ready. It was only in the previous month that the Marines had left their home base in North Carolina, and by the end of June, only a third of their number had arrived in New Zealand. General van der Grift had been told not to expect any operational duties until 1943. Now, his unprepared division was expected to go into battle in a matter of weeks. Van der Grift was forced into urgent preparations in New Zealand as his men and supplies arrived in the region. Despite an outbreak of influenza amongst his troops and the inconvenience of a strike amongst the dock workers in the port of Wellington, by the end of July, the Marine troops were in position on the island of Fiji, awaiting a final rehearsal for the task ahead. General van der Grift had by now secured a postponement of the day of attack from August the 1st to August the 7th. But he knew that his preparation time had been far from ideal, and in Fiji, the inexperience of the American Marines revealed itself. The Guadalcanal expedition would be an amphibious operation, quite unprecedented in size, and the Fiji exercise revealed the logistical difficulties involved. There was little evidence of coordination between the amphibious landing groups and the accompanying naval and air support. Equipment proved unreliable, and the whole exercise was judged to be little less than a farce, but there could be no delay in the timetable. August the 7th would be the date when the American plan would be put into action. The intentions of the American leadership for the Guadalcanal offensive were relatively straightforward. An armada of transport ships would sail from Fiji to the Solomon Islands and enter the channel to the north of Guadalcanal. There, the main amphibious force would take to their landing crafts and go ashore, while supporting units secured the smaller islands of Tulagi, Govutu, and Tamonbogo. The transport vessels would not be alone. Instead, they were just part of a much larger invasion force. To the north and northeast lay a substantial protective naval presence under the command of Admiral Crutchley of the Royal Australian Navy. 5 cruisers and 9 destroyers. Generous air support was also provided. Some 100 miles to the south, an American carrier fleet formed into position. The value of the aircraft carrier had already been proved dramatically at the Coral Sea and at Midway, and so the carriers Saratoga, Wasp, and Enterprise were deployed to provide fighter support for the Guadalcanal offensive. Alongside the carriers, 1 battleship, 6 cruisers, and some 16 destroyers. These substantial resources were all deployed in support of Vandegrift's 1st Marine Division, a landing force reinforced with crack units of paratroops and marine raiders. But nothing could hide the fact that the 1st Marine Division had only been formed recently, and that the majority of its men lacked any experience of battle. The American Marines could not be sure of the size of the force that awaited them on Guadalcanal, but they could guess at the strength of the Japanese fighting spirit. The best intelligence available suggested that a force of 7,000 troops were in position on the island, and these were likely to include soldiers with recent experience of fighting in difficult jungle conditions. By contrast, there were few men in the American Marines who had ever come across an environment like that of Guadalcanal. The Americans also knew that Japanese strength did not derive only from its positions at Guadalcanal itself. Somewhere to the northwest, in the vicinity of New Britain, lurked the might of Japanese naval power, the 4th Inner South Sea Fleet. These were the concerns that faced the American commanders on the eve of battle in early August 1942. In overall command of the Watchtower operation was Vice Admiral Robert Lee Gormley. A 57-year-old who had served as a liaison officer in London, Gormley arrived in New Zealand in March 1942 to take up command of the South Pacific area and South Pacific Force. Not long afterwards, he received the order to proceed with the Guadalcanal attack. But Gormley would not be in the South Pacific when the fighting finally ended. His eventual removal may have been the result of one of his decisions in the early days of the offensive. But in August 1942, Admiral Gormley was the man in charge. Amongst his subordinates, Rear Admiral Frank J. Fletcher, known to his men as Black Jack. A veteran of the Battle of the Coral Sea and the Battle of Midway, Fletcher was seen as an ideal choice to command the naval task force on which the success of the Guadalcanal offensive would depend. But Fletcher's reputation would also be affected by the decision of his superior, Admiral Gormley. Once again, there was no such concern when operations began. Rear Admiral Fletcher's huge task force was divided into 2 groups, with the key amphibious force under the command of Rear Admiral Richmond J. Turner. Like Gormley and Fletcher, Turner was in his late 50s, although he had never seen active combat service. Instead, he was regarded as an authority in the business of planning an amphibious attack. At Guadalcanal, he would get the chance to put his theories into practice. Rear Admiral Turner's direct subordinates included Major General Alexander A. Vandegrift, and it was this Marine commander who had become most associated with the eventual outcome at Guadalcanal. A veteran of the so-called Banana Wars in the Caribbean, Vandegrift knew all about jungle fighting. Though he was astonished when he learned how little time his 1st Marine Division would have to prepare for the offensive, this gifted soldier put aside his concerns as he took on the business of leadership on the ground. Vandegrift's Marine Division was reinforced with paratroops. It was also supported by the 1st Marine Raider Unit, under the command of Colonel Merritt Edson. Like his commander, Edson had combat experience, and it was for this reason that his raiders were given one of the most difficult tasks on the opening day of battle. Known to his men as Red Mike, Edson was a master of special tactics, and he would become one of the most celebrated soldiers of the Pacific War, with Guadalcanal the first location to witness his abilities as a leader of men. The Americans enjoyed no monopoly of excellent leadership at Guadalcanal. In charge of Japanese naval operations in the South Pacific was Vice Admiral Gunichi Mikawa. Prior to the American attack, Mikawa had expressed well-documented concerns about the fractured nature of the Japanese Pacific Command. But when fighting began, Mikawa would put his opinions to one side as he deployed his naval forces in brilliant style. Complementing Mikawa's naval forces, the Japanese regional ground presence consisted of the 17th Army of Lieutenant General Harukichi Hayakutake. General Hayakutake had a formidable force at his disposal. The 50,000 men that made up 17th Army included the 35th Infantry Brigade of Major General Kawaguchi, a commander who revealed his keenness for the fight as soon as he was engaged on Guadalcanal. A strong desire to get to grips with the enemy was also revealed by Colonel Kiyono Ichiki, a veteran of the war in China, and a passionate believer in the prowess of the individual Japanese soldier. As commander of the 2nd Battalion, 28th Infantry Regiment, Colonel Ichiki had the chance to put his beliefs to the test in the first major land action on Guadalcanal itself. It would be an engagement where Colonel Ichiki revealed just how much motivation a commander can instill in his men. It would also be an action that would give rise to one of the most enduring myths about the Guadalcanal offensive. But there can be no doubt that Colonel Ichiki experienced at first hand the power of the weapons available to his enemy. The American triumph at the Battle of Midway proved once and for all the importance of powerful carrier aircraft. And of the dive bombers available to the American commanders, there was none better than the Douglas SBD, the Dauntless. All through the Pacific War, this two-seater warplane proved a menace to Japanese ships. With one 1,600-pound fuselage-mounted bomb and two 325-pound devices on the wings, this elegant aircraft was quick to prove its value against ground positions during the fighting at Guadalcanal. Colonel Ichiki's men would become especially aware of the Dauntless's power. American commanders were also able to deploy a great carrier-borne fighter in the Guadalcanal theater, the F-4F, the Wildcat, a single-seat fighter whose distinctive form was powered by a 1,200-horsepower engine generating a top speed of 318 miles per hour. By August 1942, the Wildcat had also seen action at Midway and at the Coral Sea. And though perhaps not as great a warplane as the Dauntless, the introduction of the Wildcat proved invaluable for the American efforts at Guadalcanal. The Bell P-400 was essentially an export version of the P-39 Era Cobra, and as such, lacked, amongst other components, the ability to fit oxygen bottles, giving it a maximum ceiling of 12,000 feet. Unusable as an interceptor, its formidable armament of one nose-mounted 37mm cannon, 2.50 caliber and 4.30 caliber machine guns, together with two 500-pound bombs, ideally suited the P-400 to the ground attack role. With its unusual tricycle undercarriage and the engine placed behind the pilot, the propeller drive shaft running between his legs, the P-400 was not popular with the men who flew it. Despite this valuable support from the air, Van der Grift and his colleagues knew that they would also need substantial amounts of ground resources for the kind of jungle warfare that lay ahead. The marine troops themselves were a key resource. To get them from the transport ships to the shore, the American forces relied on landing craft like the LCI-L, the Landing Craft Infantry Large. In operation, this 160-foot vessel had the ability to deliver 210 troops to the beach via the ramp gangways fitted to either bow. The LCI-L could also be used to deliver 75 tons of material, and at Guadalcanal, American hardware on the ground included light, mobile tanks, well suited to jungle warfare. The most famous of these was the M3. First produced in 1941, its six guns were dominated by a main weapon of 37mm caliber. With armor up to 43mm thick, the M3 provided strong protection for its four-man crew. Unfortunately, a problem with the disembarkation at the Guadalcanal beachhead meant that General Van der Grift could not call on as many of these fine vehicles as he had originally hoped. But the contribution of the M3 was still crucial in some of the fiercest engagements of the offensive. The conflict on Guadalcanal saw the use, for the first time in a combat situation, of the American-built Landing Vehicle Tract, or the Alligator, developed from the rescue craft used in the swamp areas of the southern USA in the mid-1930s. Powered by two Cadillac V8 engines, propulsion through the water came from paddles attached to the tracks, which would also help mobility on soft, sandy beaches. Over 18,000 vehicles were built, including various models with differing offensive armaments, ranging from the fitting of tank turrets to the upper surfaces, through to the addition of 75mm howitzers. But the main benefit of the Alligator was its ability to drive straight out of the water and into cover before unloading its cargo, making it far less a target than ships, men, and supplies lined up on an exposed beach. Another American weapon that proved itself, not only at Guadalcanal but also in subsequent jungle battles, was the 75mm pack howitzer, the M1A1. Light and maneuverable, the pack howitzer was a long-established weapon in the American arsenal. Ideal for dropping by parachute, the M1A1 possessed a maximum range of some 9,700 yards, and the Japanese would feel the force of its 13-pound shells in the fighting of 1942. A light and versatile weapon, the 37mm gun, when used in the anti-tank role, fired a solid shot round that could penetrate 25mm of armor at 1,000 yards, and an armor-piercing round that could penetrate 58mm. Both types of rounds proved more than adequate in defeating the lightly armored tanks used by the Japanese on Guadalcanal. It was when used in the anti-personnel role that the 37mm gun proved its worth with devastating effect. Using canister fire, the gun was effectively turned into a 37mm shotgun. While posing little threat against tanks, it could decimate the frontal infantry attacks favored by the Japanese. Weighing in at 912 pounds, the gun was very light and could easily be dismantled and transported through the jungle. Over 18,000 were produced, and the gun was widely used in the Pacific theater. The standard weapon of the infantryman of the Second World War was the rifle. Most of the world's armies at this time used the hand-operated bolt-action weapon that had been in use since before the First World War. The only exception to this rule was the US military. Entering service in 1936 and standard issue by 1940, the M1 Garand rifle was a gas-operated, semi-automatic rifle fed by an 8-round magazine. Slightly heavier than the traditional rifle, the M1 Garand was a particularly reliable weapon, a significant advantage when fighting in the damp jungle conditions of Guadalcanal. But for all the quality of the American hardware, the circumstances of the Guadalcanal assault meant that not enough material was actually landed on the island. The fact that American ground commanders were not able to call on their full complement of hardware continues to be discussed today. What is certain is that when the American transport ships withdrew, half their material cargo was still on board, and the Marines left behind knew that their enemy also possessed many fine weapons of war. Success in jungle warfare can often be decided by one of the most ancient of all aspects of combat, the skill and resources of the individual soldier. And for the Japanese infantryman, much of his strength derived from the quality of his rifle, typically the Type 99. Originally introduced as the Type 38 in the early years of the 20th century, the 1930s saw this 9-pound weapon modified from its original 6.5mm caliber to accommodate a new 7.7mm cartridge. Extensively used in the fighting in China, the Type 99 was an ideal gun for the jungle sniper, and Japanese troops were also keen to use the weapon with its bayonet attached, as the American Marines found out in one of the bloodiest engagements of the Guadalcanal fighting. The Japanese infantryman could also draw confidence from the weapons used to support him. The Type 92 battalion gun may have been one of the strangest looking machines of the Second World War, but it was also one of the most widely used. Its relatively short range meant that it was often used for direct fire duties in close contact with the enemy, a task greatly assisted by its relative lightness in action. This enabled the Japanese gunners to attack, move on, and then attack again from an entirely new direction of fire. A tactic that made a disturbing impact upon the troops who found themselves in the Type 92's sights. The Japanese, like the Americans, also recognized the value of carrier-launched warplanes. And in 1942, they possessed a seaborne carrier aircraft at the peak of its powers, the legendary Mitsubishi A6M, the Zero Fighter, or as American troops christened it, the Zeke. A single-seat aircraft, the Zero was introduced in 1939, and its capabilities came to the attention of the Allies when it was used during the attack on Pearl Harbor. Its range was remarkable, its speed equally impressive, and its pilots enjoyed excellent maneuverability. The Zero's armament was also a force to be reckoned with. Two machine guns in the nose, with two 20mm cannons mounted in the wings. Developed to replace the GM3, which had been in production since 1936, the Mitsubishi G4M entered service in the spring of 1941. The G4M, or Betty Bomber, as it was known by the Americans, was the Japanese Navy's frontline land-based bomber. The Betty was armed with one cannon and four machine guns, and was also capable of carrying either a full bomb load or a single torpedo, a weapon ideally suited to the Pacific conflict. In the early stages of the war in the Pacific, the Betty proved to be a worthy opponent against the limited performance of the US fighters. But as better Allied aircraft began to enter the Pacific theater, the situation began to change. Like the Mitsubishi Zero, the Betty was designed without self-sealing tanks to increase performance and range, and subsequently became notorious with the airmen who flew it as a fire hazard. Derived from the Type 89 medium tank, which first came into service in 1929 and saw extensive service in the war with China, the Chi-Ha Type 97 was hopelessly outclassed when engaging even the smallest American tanks. The earlier Type 89's main gun could not be loaded with armor-piercing rounds, which relegated it to an infantry support vehicle. The Type 97's better armament of a 47mm gun and two machine guns could do nothing to improve its combat effectiveness. With armor plating no thicker than 30mm, under half that of its American counterpart, the Sherman. The Type 97 was used widely by the Japanese Army throughout the entire Pacific conflict. The 70mm infantry howitzer, or mountain gun Type 92, was found to be completely inadequate against American armor and was relegated to nothing more than an infantry support weapon. The one major advantage of this artillery piece during the conflict was that it was capable of being dismantled and carried by its crew of five, albeit with some difficulty, through the dense jungle and hilly terrain of Guadalcanal. A light gun, weighing 468 pounds, roughly half the weight of the comparable American gun, it fired an 8.3-pound high-explosive round up to a range of 3,000 yards. While the Japanese military failed to recognize the submachine gun as a viable infantry weapon, it regularly employed the light machine gun in an infantry support role. The Nambu 7.7mm Type 99 light machine gun was actually based on the British Bren gun and used extensively in the Guadalcanal campaign. The Nambu was an extremely accurate weapon with a high rate of fire and could even be fitted both with a bayonet and a telescopic sight. To the Japanese officer, the samurai sword was a revered symbol of the spirit of ancient Japan, believed to be the embodiment of the samurai's code, the expression of his iron discipline, and unswerving devotion to duty. The swords issued to Japanese officers were generally lower quality, mass-made examples. But as fighting weapons, and as a symbol of military authority, a sword was considered essential by Japanese officers. Even by World War II, with the development of far more effective and destructive weapons, the sword, carried into battle by a Japanese officer, held a vital link with the ancient samurai code of honor, Bushido. As the American invasion force moved into position in the Solomon Islands on the 7th of August 1942, the story of the Pacific War still had a long way to run, but the next chapter was about to begin at Guadalcanal. To the pleasant surprise of the American troops, the landing on Guadalcanal was made without the attentions of the enemy. This was fortunate, since the disembarkation proved to be as uncoordinated as the rehearsal suggested it might be. Before long, the so-called Red Beach was strewn with supplies, men, and material, and no one seemed to know who was responsible for what. But at least the Japanese were nowhere to be seen, and by the end of the day, the Marines were already moving towards the Japanese airfield. But elsewhere, the forces of the Empire were present in numbers. At Tulagi, the Marine raiders of Colonel Edson encountered fierce Japanese resistance, especially during the night that followed the landing. In the darkness of the jungle, no fewer than four Japanese assaults were beaten back, and it took until the end of the second day before Colonel Edson could report the final reduction of Japanese troops. Fierce battles were also joined at the connected islets of Gavutu and Tamonbogo, with the latter only falling after the intervention of naval support, the big guns of the destroyer Buchanan. The Americans had always expected the task of capturing the small islands to be difficult, but on Guadalcanal itself, success proved to be relatively straightforward, at least at first. By the afternoon of the second day of operations, American Marines had moved west from Red Beach to secure possession of the nearly completed Japanese airfield, a site quickly given the name Henderson Field in honour of a hero of the Battle of Midway. The Japanese forces had simply fled to the hills. As dusk fell on the 8th of August 1942, the first objective of the operation had been achieved. And although losses on the Northern Islands had been heavy, General Vandegrift could reflect on a job well done. But any overconfidence would prove to be premature. As soon as the Americans made their move, Admiral Mikawa of the Japanese 4th Inner South Sea Fleet ordered a battle group to set sail for Guadalcanal, through the Solomon Islands channel that became known as the Slot. But before they could arrive, Mikawa also dispatched a force of bombers with fighter escort against the American forces. Alerted, Admiral Fletcher dispatched 60 Wildcat fighters to greet them in the skies over Guadalcanal. In a fierce dogfight, 16 Japanese aircraft were lost against a total of 11 American planes. Admiral Turner decided to move his own fleet into defensive positions north and south of Savo Island, with the destroyers Blue and Ralph Talbot in the advanced positions. It was these outposts that were first sighted by the Japanese battle groups at 0100 hours on the morning of the 9th of August. Minutes later, Admiral Mikawa's cruiser fleet sailed past, entirely unnoticed. Now he ordered his small, cruiser-borne floatplanes into the air. At 0145 hours, their pilots began to drop flares that revealed the full presence of the Allied ships. Now Mikawa gave the order for the torpedoes to be launched and the big guns to be fired. The Battle of Savo Island had begun. The Japanese had taken their enemy by surprise, and they made their advantage pay. The Allied cruisers Vincennes, Quincy, Canberra, and Astoria were all lost. Another was seriously damaged, as the Japanese battle group swept round Savo Island and back out through the slot to the northwest. The Imperial Navy had triumphed in the first of four major battles that would take place in the seas around Guadalcanal. For the Marine commander, Vandegrift, this loss of supporting firepower was a disaster, and the Battle of Savo Island was a comprehensive victory for the Japanese. But the Americans could console themselves with the fact that Mikawa's fleet had not taken out the transport ships. But more bad news had already reached the Marines. In the hours before the Japanese attack, General Vandegrift was informed of a decision made by Admiral Fletcher. He had decided to withdraw his force of carriers in the south, having agreed with his superior, Admiral Gormley, that fuel and aircraft resources were insufficient to maintain a secure presence in the region. As a consequence of this controversial decision, Admiral Turner announced that he would also have to withdraw his amphibious task force. By the end of the 9th of August, just 2 days into the operation, Admiral Turner's ships had left Guadalcanal, taking half of the Marines' supplies and material with him. There had been no time to unload anymore. On Guadalcanal, and on the smaller islands to the north, the 1st Marine Division were left to fend for themselves. It was potentially a disastrous turn of events. There was nothing else for Vandegrift to do but secure his defensive perimeter as best he could, and set his men to the task of completing the Henderson Field airstrip. If it could be brought into operation quickly, it would be a precious asset to the now isolated Marines. The work was hampered by the lack of materials and also by the constant presence of Japanese warplanes in the skies above. Before long, the enemy would be even closer at hand. In the hot, humid jungle conditions, General Vandegrift's inexperienced men were quickly learning the often desperate facts of war. The Japanese 17th Army of Lieutenant General Hayakutake was now ordered to retake Guadalcanal, and he selected the 35th Infantry Brigade of Major General Kawaguchi to carry out the task. It was now that Rear Admiral Tanaka came up with the imaginative idea of moving troops from New Britain to Guadalcanal using fast night convoys of cruisers and destroyers, the so-called rat runs, which became known as the Tokyo Express. Such was the effectiveness of the procedure in delivering Japanese forces to Guadalcanal. On the 18th of August, with the Henderson Field still not operational, the first of these night convoys succeeded in landing two echelons of troops. To the west, a special landing force went ashore at Kokumbona. To the east, at Taivu Point, the 2nd Battalion of the 28th Infantry Regiment, under the command of Colonel Ichiki. It was a bold move, perhaps a little too bold. General Hayakutake decided not to wait for his scattered 35th Infantry Brigade to form up. Instead, he acted at once, and Ichiki's men quickly advanced from their beachhead. By the evening of the 20th of August, they had reached the edge of the American position to the east of Alligator Creek. That night, Colonel Ichiki launched his attack. It was a fearsome engagement that became known as the Battle of the Temaru. The Japanese hurled themselves at the Americans in a bayonet charge. Their courage was phenomenal as they ran into the line of American artillery, machine gun and infantry fire. When they were forced to withdraw, the inspirational Ichiki ordered the survivors to regroup, and once again they charged the American positions. But the bravery of Ichiki's men would not be enough. By the following afternoon, the Japanese assault had failed, and the last of Ichiki's men found themselves surrounded by an American force now reinforced by light armor. At some point, Colonel Ichiki himself died in the fighting, although a popular myth suggests that he committed harakiri when he realized that the battle was lost. The American victory at the Temaru was total, and the battlefield was a scene of slaughter. 800 of Ichiki's 900 men were dead. Significantly, the final elimination of the Japanese troops was assisted by American power in the air. The Henderson Field was now operational, and on August the 20th, 19 Wildcat fighters and 12 Dauntless dive bombers landed on Guadalcanal. The American occupation was now a less tentative enterprise. But the battle for the island was still far from won. In late August and early September, the ships of the Tokyo Express brought substantial numbers of troops to the east and west of Vandegrift's perimeter. In early September, the American commander brought his raiders and paratroops onto Guadalcanal itself, and on September the 7th, dispatched them east to Tasimbako, a village believed to be a center of Japanese strength. Vandegrift's intelligence was accurate. Japanese troops were based in Tasimbako, and a brief engagement resulted before the raiders captured the village. But the Japanese contingent was small, and Colonel Edson soon found out why. A far larger force had been present in Tasimbako, but they had now moved on. This was the 35th Brigade of General Kawaguchi, and it had set off south into the jungle with the likely intention of moving west before attacking Henderson Field to the north. Hurriedly, General Vandegrift organized his men into position for the suspected Japanese attack. His assumption was that his Japanese counterpart would strike against the ridge that lay to the south of the airstrip. If they did, they would find the American raiders and paratroops waiting for them. Vandegrift's assumption was correct. On the evening of the 12th of September, Japanese warships unleashed a barrage of shellfire, not against the airfield, but against the ridge that would provide the grim name for the battle to come, Bloody Ridge. It would be no exaggeration. When the Japanese shelling ceased, Kawaguchi's men made an initial assault that pushed the American defenders back. But the real attack came the following evening, September the 13th. That night saw the island of Guadalcanal enveloped in the fog of war. Kawaguchi's brigade now launched themselves forward in a heroic drive against the American positions. They were met by a line of mortar and artillery fire. But heavy Japanese firepower was also deployed from a group of seven destroyers in the coastal waters to the north. The American Wildcat pilots were also able to bring the power of their guns to bear. but still the Japanese infantry surged forward. It was a night of desperate fighting. On no fewer than 12 occasions, the Japanese troops charged the American line. On occasions, the defense appeared on the point of breaking, but the raiders and paratroops somehow held firm throughout the night. By the morning of the 14th of September, the battle was won, and what was left of Kawaguchi's force was retreating east. The ridge was covered with bodies, and it was still in American hands. Henderson Field remained secure. General Vandegrift had arrived on Guadalcanal on August the 7th with a largely inexperienced body of men. Now, 6 weeks later, they had become a battle-hardened force to be reckoned with. But there was no time for complacency. The Marines still faced many difficulties on Guadalcanal. Tropical diseases such as dysentery were rife amongst the American troops. A typical roll call revealed 1 in 5 men on the sick list. There was also the continued presence of the enemy. Vandegrift's men were allowed no respite from Japanese bombardment from the air and from the sea. By mid-October, the Japanese ground presence on Guadalcanal had also been reinforced. The commander of 17th Army had moved his headquarters to the island, and General Hayakutake could call on a force of 20,000 men for a new assault against an American presence, itself now 23,000 strong. This would be the third major Japanese attack. It would also be the last. In broad terms, General Hayakutake's plan was for a simultaneous attack from two sides. From the west, Major General Sumiyoshi would lead an assault, with armored support, against the American perimeter. At his disposal, some 5,600 men. Meanwhile, to the south, Major General Kawaguchi would attack with 7,000 men and a strong artillery element. On the evening of the 22nd of October, the Battle of Henderson Field began. To the west, an artillery barrage announced Japanese intentions. When the guns fell silent, Sumiyoshi's battalions threw themselves against the American defensive line with the support of their tanks. Now it was the turn of the American big guns to intervene. Artillery pieces and dedicated anti-tank weapons rained down their shells on the Japanese men and armor. Infantry fire was also ferocious. And despite the trademark hunger for the fight displayed by the Japanese soldier, the Western assault was completely repulsed in a matter of hours. The American positions should also have been under simultaneous attack from the south, but here there was silence. General Maruyama had found the march through the Guadalcanal jungle tough going. Too tough. At the stated moment for the assault to begin, his men were still hacking their way through the thick vegetation. Crucially, Maruyama had to abandon his mortars and artillery pieces on the way. He was also out of communication with his colleagues to the west, and was thus unable to tell Sumiyoshi to delay. It was October the 24th, before the now weakened southern sector could make its attack, and the result was predictable. More fierce fighting and victory for the American Marines, leaving behind another blood-soaked battlefield. American satisfaction was now understandable. The Marines had seen off 3 major Japanese attempts to eject them from Guadalcanal. But celebration was tempered by the loss of the American carrier Hornet, during a naval engagement to the north of Guadalcanal. This was the Battle of Santa Cruz, the last of the four great sea battles that took place while the Marines struggled to maintain their hold on land. In general, Japanese sea power around Guadalcanal proved far more effective than their operations on the island itself. Both the Japanese and the American navies lost about 25 warships in the course of their confrontations in the region. But it is as a marine operation that Guadalcanal is best remembered today. When Vandegrift's exhausted men were finally withdrawn in early December, they had endured 4 months in isolated, difficult terrain with no respite from the attentions of the enemy. 1,600 Marines had died, 4,700 had been wounded. But they had won, and the Japanese knew it. Their casualty list was four times the size. On December 31st, the Imperial Command made the decision to withdraw the remaining Japanese forces from Guadalcanal. By February the 8th, they had gone, and the American 14th Corps were left in complete control of the island. In the months that followed, the Henderson Field airstrip was built up into a major military facility. The supply lines to Australia and New Zealand were secure, and the Japanese advance had been turned back for the first time. Now the Americans could consider the future with greater confidence, and Guadalcanal would be the first staging post on the long road that lay ahead. This previously unknown patch of jungle is now deservedly famous as the first of the many islands on which Americans were forced to hop on their way to final victory. In February 1943, the armed forces of the United States stood as masters of the Pacific island of Guadalcanal. This small jungle outpost had been virtually unknown 6 months before, but it was now a name familiar to the American public. The successful invasion of Guadalcanal by the Marines of General Alexander Vandegrift had captured the national imagination, and the departure of the Japanese marked a turning point in the story of the Second World War. The seemingly relentless Japanese expansion was over, and it was now the task of America and her allies to roll back the frontiers of the empire. But it would be a long and costly enterprise. In February 1943, Japan remained in control of a vast area of the Pacific Ocean, and her forces were prepared to die to defend it. The Allies were already familiar with this powerful warrior spirit. At Guadalcanal, the Japanese defenders revealed their distaste for any idea of surrender. Death in battle was the only fitting end for a defeated Imperial soldier. In the 2.5 years that followed, the same attitude showed itself across the Western Pacific as the United States led her allies on an amazing journey from island to island towards the land of the rising sun itself. This was a period that saw some of the bloodiest fighting of the entire war, at sea, in the air, and especially on land. The names of battlefields like Tarawa, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa are now synonymous with close-quarter fighting of the bitterest kind. The Japanese desire to fight on to the end resulted in casualty lists of biblical proportions, and few were taken prisoner. The missions of Japanese kamikaze pilots have also come to typify the disregard for life amongst Imperial fighting men. Even when the Allies had fought their way to the edge of Japan itself, it took the most deadly weapon ever created, finally, to bring the conflict to an end. The journey from Guadalcanal to Nagasaki remains one of the most revealing chapters in the history of warfare. The American triumph at Guadalcanal forced the Japanese Imperial Command to consider a new strategy for the prosecution of the Pacific War. 6 weeks after the Japanese withdrawal, the new approach was decided. In essence, it was a defensive strategy that aimed to secure control of key strongholds across a vast front line, while allowing for the possibility of a counterattack if the opportunity existed. March 1943 also saw the agreement of the Allied strategy for the conflict to come. At the Washington Pacific Conference, the American Joint Chiefs of Staff decided to pursue a two-pronged attack through the many islands of the Western Pacific. The Southwest Pacific Command was given responsibility for an advance beginning at Guadalcanal, its task to sweep through the Solomon Islands and New Guinea towards the islands of the Philippines. In overall command, the charismatic Douglas MacArthur, the general who had famously sworn to return to the Philippines after the Japanese conquest of March 1942. To the north, the Central Pacific Area Command of Admiral Chester Nimitz was allocated the second thrust of the American offensive. This would involve a vast naval force advancing from island to island across thousands of kilometers of ocean, from the Gilbert Islands through the Marshalls and Carolines to the Marianas. Eventually, the two prongs of the offensive would converge for a final unified assault on the island of Formosa, before moving against the islands of Japan itself. It was an audacious plan, but the vast amount of naval material required for Nimitz's objectives was still not available in early 1943. So it was the forces of Douglas MacArthur that began the task of pushing back the frontiers of the Japanese Empire. It would be an achievement of epic proportions. In the spring of 1943, the American Southwest Pacific Command considered its options for the task that now faced them. It was already obvious that the main Japanese stronghold in the region was the fortress of Rabaul on the island of New Britain. This was the headquarters of the Japanese 8th Area Army, a force of 100,000 fighting men. If Rabaul could be destroyed, then further progress towards the Philippines would become a far easier enterprise. By early May 1943, General MacArthur and his colleagues had determined their plan. MacArthur himself would lead an advance along the northeast coast of New Guinea, driving the Japanese back before crossing over to New Britain. At the same time, his deputy, Admiral William Bull Halsey, would lead an invasion force from Guadalcanal through the Solomon Islands so that Rabaul could be attacked from two sides. The operation was given the codename Cartwheel, and on the 30th of June, 1943, the fight back in the Pacific began. That day, the 43rd American Infantry Division took to their landing craft for an assault on the Solomon Island of Rendova. The island was lightly defended, and 2 days later, the American troops were able to land on the island of New Georgia. Their objective was now the Japanese airfield at Munda. It was just 10 kilometers away, but it would take a month of bitter fighting before American troops secured the position. A massive artillery barrage was required, but not even the power of the 155mm howitzer shells could force the Japanese to abandon Munda. It took the intervention of American air power and reinforcements on the ground before the airfield was finally taken. This was an inauspicious beginning to the eastern thrust of Operation Cartwheel. Admiral Halsey knew that there were far more substantial Japanese positions located at Kolombangara, and especially Bougainville. This was the headquarters of the 17th Army of General Harukichi Hayukotake, a veteran of the Guadalcanal fighting. But the American commander proved equal to the challenge. Much to the surprise of Hayukotake, Halsey ordered that Kolombangara should be bypassed. Instead, he dispatched American and New Zealander troops to the more lightly defended island of Vella La Vella. 2 months later, in early November, Halsey also achieved tactical surprise by launching his attack on Bougainville from the west. General Hayukotake had not anticipated a landing in this swamp region, but by the time he scrambled his forces in response, the American Marines were establishing a bridgehead on the island. With this achieved, the Japanese commander was never able to regain the initiative, and Bougainville eventually fell on November the 26th. The eastern objectives of Operation Cartwheel had now been fully achieved. To the west, General MacArthur had also enjoyed considerable success. On the vast jungle island of New Guinea, Allied troops had been at grips with the enemy well before the attack in the Solomon Islands. Early in 1943, an Australian garrison at Wau had been engaged in a bitter fight to hold the position in the face of a keen Japanese assault. Only a last-minute airborne reinforcement of troops had saved the Australians from defeat, and the Japanese offensive was finally abandoned at the end of February. It had been a bloody engagement. 200 Australians lost their lives in bitter, close-quarter jungle fighting. But 1,200 Japanese also died at Wau. And by spring 1943, the Australian troops of General Savage's 3rd Division were ready to play their part in support of Operation Cartwheel. On April the 26th, the Australian men left their base at Wau and set off towards the coast. Their destination was a position near to the Japanese base at Salamoa. It was a journey of just 55 kilometers to the east, but it would take 2 months to cover the ground. The jungle was virtually impenetrable, and the Australians also had to contend with enemy outposts deep in the rainforest. It was the 29th of June before the exhausted units eventually arrived at the coast. But they had achieved their objective. Australian troops now joined together with a landing party of American infantry to attack Japanese positions at Suramoa and Lae. Despite a vigorous defense, by the 11th of September, the Japanese were retreating into the mountains in the face of the combined Allied attack. By the 22nd of September, Australian forces had arrived at the Japanese base of Finschhafen. But the site was deserted. The Japanese now chose to concentrate their resources in the regions of Sattelberg, and it took another bloody engagement before this stronghold fell on the 25th of November 1943. But victory at Sattelberg meant that the western thrust of Operation Cartwheel had also completed its objective. The next day, some 800 kilometers to the east, American Marines completed the capture of Bougainville, and the Japanese stronghold of Rabaul was now under threat from two sides, as planned. But MacArthur and his colleagues had already realized that an assault on the Japanese 8th Army was unnecessary. Simply isolating it would be enough. It was a far less costly approach. After establishing a defensive position on southern New Britain, early in 1944, American and New Zealand troops moved to capture the small islands to the north. The Rabaul base was effectively surrounded, and 100,000 troops found themselves cut off from the war. With this achieved, MacArthur's American forces moved against the northern coast of New Guinea. On the 22nd of April 1944, an amphibious landing of some 80,000 men arrived at the Japanese stronghold of Hollandia, only to find it abandoned. The Japanese presence on the island was now in retreat, and with the Rabaul base cut off, there was little that their commanders could do to halt the Allied progress, despite the best efforts of their men on the ground. By the 15th of September, a delighted Douglas MacArthur was able to report his arrival on the island of Moratai. the Philippines were now within striking distance. MacArthur's promise that he would return to the islands was now on the point of being realized, and the Pacific War as a whole was going to plan. In late 1943, far away in the Gilbert Islands, the men of Admiral Nimitz began their journey across the Central Pacific. But this first step gave Nimitz and his colleagues a hint of what lay ahead on the path to victory. On the 20th of November 1943, American Marines launched an amphibious assault on the island of Tarawa. Within days, the American public knew that victory in the Pacific would come at a price. Tarawa was a tiny objective, an island just 3 kilometers in length, but it took the loss of 1,000 American troops to capture it. Many of these men never reached the shore. Survivors recalled one Japanese machine gunner who trained his weapon on the opening bow doors of the American landing craft. For those troops caught in his line of fire, there was little chance of survival. Not for the last time, the warm shore waters of the Pacific Ocean were filled with the bodies of the dead. Tarawa was a taste of things to come. When the Japanese guns eventually fell silent, the island air was filled with the smell of death. Only 17 of the 4,200 Japanese defenders were taken alive. Prisoners of war would be a rare phenomenon during the Pacific conflict. For the vast majority of Japanese fighting men, surrender to the enemy was an option filled with shame. It was quite literally a fate worse than death, and it is this that provides the main explanation for the tiny numbers of war prisoners taken in the Pacific. But there was also another reason. For the Allies, taking Japanese prisoners could be a risky business. At Guadalcanal, American troops had discovered the fanaticism of their enemy. Many commanders reported occasions when a wounded Japanese came forward in apparent surrender. When an American Marine went to attend to his defeated adversary, the Japanese pulled the pin on a suicide grenade that also killed his captor. From Guadalcanal onwards, American forces remained wary of taking any prisoners alive, a concern that goes some way towards explaining the appalling death rolls that characterized the Pacific War. But the slaughter at Tarawa was still a shock to the American public in 1943, and Admiral Nimitz was determined to learn any lessons that he could from the carnage. For his next objective, the Marshall Island of Kwajalein, the American commander did everything in his power to minimize the Japanese threat before his ground troops attacked. A 3-day bombardment from the ships and carrier planes of American Task Force 58 was launched against Kwajalein before American infantrymen went ashore on February 1, 1944. But as Nimitz must have suspected, not even this could neuter the fighting spirit of the individual Japanese soldier. On the 4th of February, the American commander was informed that Kwajalein had finally been taken. 173 men of his 7th Infantry Division had lost their lives. 4,938 Japanese had shared their fate. Even when the battle was all but lost, the soldier of the Japanese Empire refused to surrender, and it was left to American flamethrower units to complete the grim conquest of Kwajalein. A similar loss of life was also reported on the Marshall Island atoll of Inuitok. Here, the Japanese lost all but 64 of 2,700 men by the time the island was taken on the 21st of February. Again, an initial bombardment by American naval and air forces contributed to the death toll, but as on Kwajalein, it was a much closer kind of combat that finally secured the capture of the island. It was now clear to Nimitz and his fellow commanders that the deployment of ground troops had to be a measure of last resort. If strategic objectives could be attained without face-to-face fighting, then that would be the favored option. Douglas MacArthur recognized this when he decided not to attack the stronghold of Rabaul. In February 1944, Admiral Nimitz came to a similar decision concerning the Japanese naval base at Truk Lagoon in the Caroline Islands. The physical capture of the island was not essential. Instead, Nimitz ordered a massive two-day air assault beginning on the 17th of February 1944. 9 waves of Hellcat fighters, Avenger torpedo bombers, and Dauntless dive bombers transformed a paradise island into a scene of carnage. Of the 275 Japanese aircraft situated on Truk, just one was left in operation by the end of the so-called Operation Hailstone. With Truk now effectively isolated, Nimitz was able to proceed to his next objectives in the Mariana Islands. By now, American industrial strength was securing a strategic advantage in the war. In June 1944, Nimitz's deputy, Admiral Raymond Spruance, stood in command of a task force whose complement of aircraft carriers alone totaled 15. On board, a total of 900 warplanes. The Japanese leadership knew that the balance of materials was turning against them. They also knew that the loss of the Marianas would be a catastrophe for the Empire. If the islands were lost, Japan itself would be within range of the heavy American bombers. When the first amphibious landing was made on Saipan on June the 15th, the Imperial Navy was given the task of making a desperate strike against the huge American fleet. Vice Admiral Yoshiburo Ozawa now took command of a task force comprising 55 warships, including 9 carriers with 473 aircraft. These included the Zero fighter that the Americans had first encountered at Pearl Harbor, and which remains one of the most famous warplanes of the 20th century. But by mid-1944, the legendary Zero found itself outclassed by the American Hellcat, and when Vice Admiral Ozawa dispatched his first wave of aircraft in the direction of the Marianas on June the 19th, 1944, he must have suspected the likely outcome. The Battle of the Philippine Sea marked the end of the Japanese ability to wage carrier warfare in the Pacific. The American task force, stationed to the northwest of Guam, not only possessed better aircraft, they also possessed every detail of the enemy plan of attack, having succeeded in cracking the Japanese code system. On the morning of June the 19th, 1944, Ozawa launched 4 successive waves against the American fleet. It became known as the Great Marianas Turkey Shoot. In just 3 hours of air combat, a total of 243 Japanese warplanes were lost. Only 30 American craft shared their fate. But the Battle of the Philippine Sea was not yet over. Despite his losses, Vice Admiral Ozawa was keen to re-engage the enemy after making a tactical withdrawal. The American Task Force commander, Mark Mitcher, was also willing to continue the fight. When his reconnaissance planes located the Japanese fleet on the afternoon of June the 20th, Mitcher ordered his Hellcats, Avengers, and Dauntlesses into the air, even though their objective was at the absolute limit of their range. When the American aircraft arrived, the result was another bitter blow for the Japanese, with the carrier Hio sent to the bottom by a twin torpedo attack. But the engagements of the 20th of June 1944 were not entirely one-sided. 100 American aircraft were also lost, some of them in combat. A far greater number forced to ditch at sea after running out of fuel on the way back to the carriers. Despite this, the Battle of the Philippine Sea was a triumph for the Americans, and in Tokyo, the loss of so many Japanese aircraft forced the resignation of the Prime Minister, Hideki Tojo. The Allied assault on the Marianas could now continue without interference from the air. By July the 7th, the major objective of Saipan had been achieved, though here, once again, the occupying ground forces revealed a fanatical desire to fight to the end. On the last day of fighting, the Japanese commander Yoshitsugu Saito ordered a final infantry charge into a line of American artillery and machine gun fire. 3,000 men died, including their commander, by the ritual suicide of harakiri. With the fall of Saipan, the end began to loom for the once mighty Japanese Empire. By the end of July 1944, the Marianas were an American possession, and Japan now faced the menace of long-range strategic bombing by the B-29 Super Fortress. In August 1945, it was also from a Marianas airfield that the most devastating bomber raid of all was launched. But a year earlier, the American High Command was still dependent on conventional weaponry as the Pacific Offensive continued. By the late summer of 1944, the twin thrust strategy had forced the Japanese to retreat across a vast area of territory. But the American leadership now had to consider the next steps towards the islands of Japan. Originally, the intention had been for the forces of MacArthur and Nimitz to converge on the southern Philippines and push toward the island of Formosa before heading north. But it was well known that MacArthur favoured the capture of the entire Philippine chain, and when his deputy, Admiral Halsey, reported only light Japanese defences in the south of the Philippines during a raid in September 1944, President Roosevelt decided to modify the American Pacific strategy. MacArthur would be responsible for liberating the Philippines, while Nimitz would head northwest towards Iwo Jima, Okinawa, and the fringes of Japan itself. The Pacific War was still far from over. With Japanese defenses in the southern Philippines apparently light, MacArthur decided to bypass the island of Mindanao and make his landing in the center of the country. On the 20th of October 1944, in an emotional homecoming, Douglas MacArthur once again set foot on Philippine soil as his amphibious landing force secured their beachhead. MacArthur could take confidence in the naval force that defended him, the American 3rd and 7th Fleets, a total of 800 ships. And this vast armada soon found itself involved in the largest naval battle that the world has ever seen, the Battle of Leyte Gulf. As soon as the Japanese Imperial Command received news of MacArthur's landing, they made the decision to deploy their naval forces in a final attempt to stem the American advance. In overall command, the Tokyo-based Admiral Soemo Toyoda. At sea, Admiral Takeo Kurita took charge. And it was this 55-year-old commander who almost pulled off a famous victory. Kurita's plan was to engage the American fleet positioned to the east of the Philippines in support of the landings at Leyte. 39 warships would attack from the west in a two-prong pincer, but Kurita also deployed another decoy carrier group in the direction of the northeast. This was a force that was superficially strong. 17 vessels, including 4 aircraft carriers, under the command of Admiral Yusiburo Ozawa. But there were virtually no aircraft on board. The whole group was a sacrificial offering, intended to lure Admiral Halsey's 3rd Fleet away from its position in support of the Leyte landings. And the American commander took the bait. On the 24th and 25th of October 1944, the Battle of Leyte Gulf unfolded. For the Japanese, the results were initially mixed. Although the US carrier Princeton was destroyed in a dive bomber attack, American aircraft succeeded in destroying the huge Japanese battleship, the Musashi. Worse still, the southern half of Kurita's pincer found itself trapped overnight in the narrow Surigao Strait, where its vessels were wiped out by the big American naval guns. But Admiral Kurita's northern group remained intact, having made a tactical nighttime withdrawal to the San Bernardino Strait. And the American Third Fleet was now sailing away from this main Japanese deployment. During the afternoon of October the 24th, Admiral Halsey was informed of what appeared to be the main Japanese attack force. The commander already reveled in the nickname Bull Halsey because of his habit of making immediate charges on the enemy, and now he lived up to his reputation. By ordering his fleet to sail north, he left the 7th Fleet of Admiral Kincaid exposed, and in the morning, Admiral Kurita sailed into Leyte Gulf to face a drastically weakened force. The decoy plan had worked. Kurita's battle group now engaged the American battle group known as Taffy 3, and Rear Admiral Clifton Sprague found himself outnumbered. Three of his destroyers were sunk. The carrier Gambler Bay also went down as the American ships manoeuvred desperately to escape Kurita's attack. Appeals for help were sent to the departed Halsey in the north, but it was only when Admiral Nimitz himself intervened that the Third Fleet finally turned around. Halsey had been fooled, and his fleet was still unable to assist his colleagues. The American landings on Leyte were in real danger. But now the Japanese commander made a mistake of his own. Uncertain of the size of the American force that faced him, Admiral Kurita decided to withdraw. The Americans could hardly believe it. Their landings on the Philippines were secure. But the Battle of Leyte Gulf had one final sting in the tail. On the evening of the 25th of October, the American 7th Fleet was attacked by a new kind of weapon from the air. Obsolete aircraft, packed with explosives, and piloted by young Japanese men, fully aware that they would die in the course of their mission. These were the pilots of the so-called Divine Wind, the kamikaze. And it was at Leyte Gulf that the Americans first felt the power of the suicide bombers. In the months that followed, a total of 40 American ships were destroyed by this unsettling weapon of last resort, and thousands of lives were lost in the process. If there were any lingering doubts about the willingness of the Japanese to die for their country, the introduction of the kamikaze removed them once and for all. Despite this, the American bridgehead on the Philippines was secure by the end of October 1944, and there could be no doubt in Tokyo that the war was now a lost cause. The Battle of the Philippine Sea had wiped out the Japanese power in the air, and the Battle of Leyte Gulf marked the final effective appearance of the Imperial Navy. But the fanatical resistance of Japanese ground troops continued, and it was this that led the United States to consider the use of terrifying new weapons, finally to bring the war to its end. The fighting for the Philippines typified the Japanese desire to fight on to the death. Tens of thousands of defending troops lost their lives by the time the capital, Manila, fell in early March 1945. Tragically, 100,000 citizens also died before Douglas MacArthur could fulfill his promise to return to the Philippine capital. Bitter, close-quarter fighting continued in the Philippines right up till the end of the war, as MacArthur initiated a series of amphibious landings to retake all of the islands. As late as September 1945, pockets of Japanese resistance continued to hold out with no thought of surrender. But the battle for the Philippines had effectively ended earlier in the year, as the attention of the American public turned to the progress of Admiral Nimitz's force in the northwest, with the greatest interest in the outcome of two amphibious island invasions. Operations that, more than anything, persuaded the American leadership to turn to the ultimate weapon to bring the war to an end. By February 1945, bombing raids on the Japanese home islands had become commonplace, but the B-29s taking off from airfields in the Marianas still lacked effective fighter protection. The island of Iwo Jima could provide a base for American fighters, and so the decision was made to make an amphibious assault on Iwo Jima beginning in February 1945. It would be the first of two amphibious assaults that would be amongst the bloodiest episodes of the entire Second World War. On February the 19th, 1945, American Marines began their arrival on the beaches of Iwo Jima, and it seemed at first as if their task would be a simple one. The island had been subjected to a ferocious bombing campaign, and the landing troops encountered nothing in the way of resistance on the shores. But it was a very different story inland. Under the command of Tadamichi Kurabayashi, a total of 21,000 men had dug themselves into deep defensive positions, with the peak of Mount Suribachi a focus for the defense. Within hours of landing, the American Marines realized that these soldiers would have to be flushed out almost one by one, with explosives and flamethrowers often proving more effective than infantry or artillery fire. Predictably, it was a terrifying task. The Marines had to engage an enemy for whom death was the greatest honor attainable in battle. Soon, the smell of slaughter filled the air as the assault on Mount Suribachi began. To add to the unsettling nature of the task, the offshore American fleet found itself attacked by the kamikaze as the land fighting continued. At times, the American advance was slowed almost to a halt by the tenacity of the Japanese defense. But on the morning of the 23rd of February, 4 days into the assault, the Stars and Stripes flew from the highest point of Iwo Jima. It remains one of the most striking images of the Second World War. Even as the flag was being raised, American construction battalions had begun the task of building new airstrips as the Japanese resistance slowly drew to its inevitable end. By the end of March, American victory on Iwo Jima was complete, and a vital new airbase was in full service. But the price had been high. 6,800 United States servicemen died in the battle for Iwo Jima. All but 200 of the 21,000 Japanese lost their lives. In the subsequent fighting for the island of Okinawa, the death toll was even higher. In a virtually identical operation, the American dead alone totaled 15,500. 80,000 Japanese shared their fate, along with 42,000 civilians. It was a horrific outcome. But for many Americans, it was the Japanese tactics at Okinawa that were more unsettling than the statistics of death rolls. On April 7th, the American offshore fleet was attacked by the biggest ever kamikaze attack. Some 350 pilots, flying aircraft packed with explosives, descended from the sky and aimed their planes at the American ships. And this was just the first of many kamikaze raids on the American fleet at Okinawa. By the time the island was eventually taken, after 12 weeks of fighting, some 32 vessels had been lost to the kamikaze, and 5,000 seamen lost their lives. Many Americans found the very idea of suicide bombing disturbing. They wondered what kind of enemy they were dealing with. The Japanese were now desperate to try any tactic that might make an impact, no matter what the cost in lives. On the same day as the first big kamikaze raid at Okinawa, a flotilla of 10 Japanese warships arrived on the scene. This was all that was left of a once proud navy, and it included the 64,000-ton Yamato, the biggest battleship ever built. But the Yamato's journey to Okinawa would be its last. Like the other ships, it was only given fuel for a one-way journey. The Japanese High Command knew the fate that awaited their pitiful fleet, but they were prepared for the loss of life if it could hamper the American invasion in any way. As events transpired, the monster Yamato made no impact at all. With all remaining Japanese fighters deployed in support of the kamikaze attack, the vessel was left as an easy target for American bombs and torpedoes. In less than an hour, three waves of attack sent the Yamato to the bottom, long before she reached Okinawa. It was as devastating as it was predictable, and it was typical of Japanese tactics in the face of defeat. There can be no doubt that the slaughter on Iwo Jima and on Okinawa had a deep impact on the thinking of the American leadership. The likely loss of American lives in a full-scale invasion of Japan could only be guessed at, if, as seemed likely, the enemy was prepared to fight to the death. But in the early months of 1945, another option began to grow in favor. From November 1944 onwards, the Japanese home islands received regular visits from American bomber squadrons. But in early 1945, the commander of 21st American Bomber Command conceived a devastating new strategy to force the ordinary Japanese citizen to accept that the war was lost. On the evening of the 9th of March, General Curtis LeMay gave the order for a very different kind of bombing raid from anything that had gone before. That night, 280 US bombers took off on a low-level mission against the very center of Japanese power, Tokyo itself. Their cargo, 2,000 tons of incendiary devices. American planners knew that the Japanese capital was built largely of wood, and a concentrated attack using napalm bombs could produce a terrible impact on the city. Their analysis proved accurate. On the night of the 9th-10th March 1945, Tokyo was set ablaze. The cumulative effect of the napalm devices rendered futile any attempts to extinguish the fires that engulfed the city. For a time, the atmosphere itself took light, and as many as 100,000 citizens may have perished as a result of one bombing raid. It was an overwhelming display of force. But if the American leadership hoped that such an enormous loss of life would bring their Japanese counterparts to the negotiating table, they were wrong. Although Japan was now hopelessly defeated as a military power, the war carried on, and the hellscape of Okinawa was still to come. By July 1945, many American citizens were resigned to the prospect of an invasion of Japan, an enterprise whose potential cost in lives could hardly be overestimated. But the American leadership was now in a position to finish the war in the most dramatic manner possible. For years, Allied scientists had been working in secret on a new kind of weapon, a bomb with a destructive power like nothing ever seen before, the atomic bomb. On July the 16th, 1945, at a site in the deserts of New Mexico, the new weapon was tested for the first time, and its power was obvious. With the atomic bomb, the United States could at last force the Japanese to accept their defeat. On the 6th of August, 1945, an American B-29 bomber, the Enola Gay, took off from a Marianas airfield. It flew at a height of 31,000 feet over the city of Hiroshima. At 8:16 a.m. local time, an atomic weapon was released into the Japanese sky. 43 seconds later, the atomic bomb exploded over Hiroshima, and as many as 80,000 people died in an instant. Now, the Japanese leadership knew that their country could be completely destroyed at virtually no cost to their American enemies. Following the second atomic attack on Nagasaki on the 9th of August, the Japanese high command accepted the inevitable, and the formal surrender of Japanese forces was soon a reality. World War II was over. But it had been a long, hard, and in the end, terrifying enterprise. Beginning at Guadalcanal, the Americans and their allies had forced their way across a vast area of the planet's surface. With every engagement, they encountered the remarkable spirit of the Japanese fighting man. In the end, it was the superior industrial and technological might of the United States that gained victory in the Pacific. But it was a triumph that had to be secured on the ground, on some of the bloodiest battlefields of the Second World War.